The word of God says, for what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them, for his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they're without excuse. God is telling us that it's obvious to us, even though you might hate the idea, that there is a God in heaven, and the very creation you're standing in screams out the evidence, there is a God, there is a God. Now, many men try to repress that knowledge in themselves because they know that they will not measure up to God's standard, and they love their sin more than they love God. But it's interesting to find that atheists tend to swing really hard and fight really hard to prove their point because they know in their heart there is a God. But you know, when God has given us this creation we live in, I mean, even one of your eyes has 130 million light-sensitive cells in it. You know, the evolutionist is saying that in the beginning, nothing created all this, and it is a fairy tale for adults. And I think that we often take this for granted. I'm sorry, I can't hear you, ma'am. That we often take this for granted that God has given us this wonderful place to live, this amazing creation called Earth that we live on, and these bodies that he's given us and the air that we breathe. But do we ever think, what does God require of us? And you know, God has given us a law for us to live by. It's known as the Ten Commandments or God's moral law. And you know that each one of us one day will stand before God, our judge, the creator of heaven and earth. And if he judges you by the law that he's given, would you pass the test? And you know, if you had a court date here in Calgary at the Court of Queen's Bench, you would see a lawyer before you went to court to see how you would do. And it's the same thing. A man should examine himself and see whether he would pass the test on the day of judgment. You know, we're told that God give us life, and that our command is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Now, how many of us could honestly say that we've done that? It says you shall not lie. How many times have we lied in our lives? And if we're honest, it'd be more than we could count. But lying lips, the scriptures say, are an abomination to the Lord. He that breathes out lies will not escape. And all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire. Apparently, God sees lying as a big insult, a big offense against himself, the creator of heaven and earth, the one that is the lawgiver. If we steal, we're a thief. If you're a lying thief that has failed to love God, we've already found that you've broken the law, and there is trouble for you in the days ahead when you stand before God in judgment. But he goes on to say, if you blaspheme God's name, you misuse his name, you say, oh my, and insert the name of your creator, or use the name of Jesus Christ as a cuss word, he said, I will not hold him blameless, he uses my name in vain. Like any of you, if I used your mother's name as a cuss word, you would be offended by that. But yet the very creator, am I right? If I used your mother's name as a cuss word, you'd maybe even at least think about taking a swing at me, right? Because that would be offensive to you, right? If I cussed your mom's name. Right. But many of us have taken the creator of heaven and earth, his name. Absolutely not, sir. I'm doing this because I'm warning other people.
What?
Of the sin, there's a day that they will be judged by God, and that if any of us have sinned before God, we'll have to answer for him.
I hope so.
Hope
God comes. Christ.
Where is he going to do it? Are we all going to see him?
Absolutely, sir. Because God has appointed a day. The question here is, will we see God when he comes? God has appointed a day that he will judge the world in righteousness. And if we've broken any of these laws, if we've lied or stolen or hated or looked with lust, failed to love God more than anything, then we've broken God's law. And the scriptures say clearly that no thief, no blasphemer, no adulterer, no fornicator will enter the kingdom of God. And I think that covered all of us here. And the scriptures say clearly that all have sinned, every one of us. We've broken God's law and are deserving of punishment. And God, being just and righteous, should judge everyone that has broken His law, just like any good judge should. I will by no means clear the guilty, God says. But though God is a God of justice, we must say also that God is a God of great love and mercy. That even though we are by nature, like our father Adam, rebels against God, and we have sinned against Him more times than we can count, that God is a God of amazing mercy, and that God sent His Son, God the Son in the flesh, in the person of Jesus Christ, born of a virgin 2,000 years ago, lived that perfect life that you and I haven't lived, and offered Himself as a sacrifice for sin. He allowed men to pound nails in His hands and His feet. He was lifted up on a cross where He bled and He died. God poured out the punishment on Him that you and I deserve for breaking God's law. But then God raised Him from the dead. Think of the mercy of God, that though we should be judged for breaking God's law, God is loving and merciful, and that He sent His Son, Jesus Christ, God in the flesh, to bleed and die for the sins of His people, for those that would repent and believe in Him alone. My friend, you and I both deserve judgment before God, because God said He looked down on the children of earth to see if there was any that doeth good. And there was none that doeth good. No, not one. They've altogether gotten out of the way, altogether become unprofitable. Every one of us deserves judgment, and we know that a good judge can never let a criminal go. For a good judge to overlook somebody's crime would mean he's corrupt and a bad judge. And if one of you had a loved one that was murdered, and the murderer stood in this city before the judge and said, "I'm guilty, Your Honor," and then asked the judge to let him go, if the judge let him go, you'd be screaming up and down in front of the courthouse about injustice, and we'd be with you. But many of you, I suspect, are hoping that God will overlook your crimes before Him on the day of judgment. And God said, "I will by no means clear the guilty." But there is mercy and there is hope because of His Son, Jesus Christ. God can maintain His righteousness and be a good judge by paying a fine for you. God has promised to pay the fine for those that repent and believe. But you are in, as the scriptures say, the valley of decision. There is a day, this day you're hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. What are you going to do? Will you repent of your sin? Will you cry out to God for mercy because of His Son, Jesus Christ, that bled and died for the sins of His people? Or will you reject? But how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? God Himself offered Himself as payment for our sin when in the person of Jesus Christ He bled and died on the cross. But many people, maybe most people, will reject Him and will be standing before God condemned. Because God said in His scriptures that Jesus Christ did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. And it goes on to say that the world is already condemned. Why? Because like our father Adam, we have broken God's law. And the guilt of Adam was passed down to us, and it's proven. The words of Jesus Himself said, "Those that sin are a slave to sin." And sin is simply breaking God's law.
There's no external protection. By your definition, everything is sin. Therefore,
All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
God is not this being in the sky who rewards us or condemns us. God is our life force. God comes from within. Every major religion has a pathway to God.
Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life, sir. No man cometh to the Father but by me."
But Christ was a human being who was alive 2,000 years ago. Right. Then, those words were truth and relevant. Now, I'm not so sure.
No. How can it be? How can Jesus say, "I'm the way, the truth, and life"? And then,
because, did you not just hear what I said?
No, I heard what you said.
Yeah.
There is no other name written among men whereby we must be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. And many people think there are many ways to God, that as long as you follow some kind of religion or try to be good, that you can be made right before God. But that is just simply bringing condemnation on yourself, because by the deeds of the law, by trying to live righteously, shall no man be justified before God. And this poor man here is trusting in his own righteousness to get him to heaven. But God says that none of us are righteous, that all men have sinned before God. And trying to be to act in a good way and be nice to your neighbors, well, it's a very good thing to do, will never erase your guilt before God. It will never erase your guilt. When you commit a crime in this country of Canada, no matter how good you are to your neighbors from then on, it will never erase the guilt for that crime. And it's the same thing that every one of us have committed crimes against God. And no matter how good you try to act from then on, it won't erase your guilt. But God is merciful in that He sent His Son, Jesus Christ. He sent His Son to take the punishment for sin for those that would believe. He said to the Apostle Paul, "Or do you presume on the riches of His kindness and forbearance, and the patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance?" So God give us this world to live in, that it's an amazing place, though we actually mess it up quite a bit. But it's an amazing creation that we live in. The kindness of God, that He has given us this land of plenty, meant to lead us to repentance, that we would see the power of God. We would see that we have not measured up to His standard, and we would bow the knee to Him through His Son, Jesus Christ, repenting or confessing and turning from our sins and trusting in Jesus Christ alone. But the Scripture goes on to say, "But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works." And like a good judge, God will judge the living and the dead. When all men stand before God, and He will reward each one for his works. The problem is, God says that all have sinned, and there is none that doeth good. So the reward for our works, the wages of sin is death, the Scriptures say. But the gift of God is salvation through Jesus Christ alone. So God is just, and He is holy. He loves that which is good and righteous. But that demands that He hates that which is unrighteous and evil. And the heart of man, He says, does nothing but evil continually. But there is mercy in the Savior, and that God sent His Son, Jesus Christ, to bleed and to die for sin. God is kind, and He's given us this wonderful place to live, and the air that we breathe. But we've rebelled against Him. God is merciful and just. So if you bow the knee to Him and trust in Jesus Christ alone, repent of your sin, your sins can be forgiven you, because Jesus paid for those sins on the cross by dying 2,000 years ago. And I know that the natural man hates the good news of the gospel. The natural, by nature, we hate to hear that we have sinned before God. But to think of the mercy of God, and that He sent His Son to die for the sin of His people. If the only way that your life could be saved is by giving the life of my Son, I would let you die. Not that I don't love you, that's why I'm standing here preaching this message, but because I love my Son more. But God, who is rich in mercy, He gave His Son to bleed and die for the sin of His people. What a merciful God this is. So as you hear this message, you may think this is foolishness, and you may just walk away, but I ask you, God is commanding you to repent and believe. Repent of your sin and believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you very much for listening.